great to have you here in person as well as online. Hope you're ready to worship this morning. Let's sing this together this morning.
For so long I carried the weight of my past, crippled by burdens like stones on my back. I thought I had fallen too far from your grace, but you came and showed me the way. When I was a lost soul searching, you were the ground beneath my feet. When I was a blind man begging, you were the eye so I could see. When the smoke was rising up, you were the air that I could breathe. You gave me hope, you gave me something to believe. Come on! Now I'm alive and born again, rescued from the grip of sin. God, your love came crashing in and pulled me out of the fire. I'm a survivor. I'm a survivor. I'm a survivor.
Now all I can see are the fields of your grace. Wherever I run,
you're leading the way. You shook the shackles off my feet. I found redemption on my knees. You gave me hope, you gave me something to believe. Now I
in your heart to the Lord and sing this. Just sing that first verse again.
For so long I carried the weight of my past, crippled by burdens like stones on my back. I thought I had fallen too far from your grace. You came and showed me the way.
Really like the imagery of that song.
that picture of us being rescued from a burning building, being lost, being blind, not able to breathe, in danger of being burned. And yet God shows up and rescues us. I was thinking about that concept this week of being a survivor. And it was in 2 Peter, I think it's 2 Peter 1, where it says this: "For his divine power has bestowed on us absolutely everything necessary for a dynamic spiritual life and goodness." And it occurred to me that his word actually says we're not only survivors, but we have everything that we need to be thrivers. That a survivor-only mindset can get us stuck in the struggle that I think we all have daily, that says, I'm not good enough, I'm not smart enough, I'm not strong enough, I'm not, fill in the blank. What's the lie that the enemy tells you? And yet, if we incorporate 2 Peter, it's a mindset that lets us see God and what his word says we are. And so, Abba, this morning, we just thank you that we are enough because you're enough. That we're your kids. You call us your children. That we're chosen by you. We're accepted by you. That your word says that we're forgiven and we're free from condemnation. That we're redeemed. And that you see us as the righteousness of Jesus. Father, we thank you that your word says that we're greatly loved by you and nothing can separate us from your love. And so we respond this morning by singing your praise. Come on, respond to him and sing this.
How can I keep from singing your praise? And how can
to the rock I
Thank you for the freedom that we have to get together as your children with our spiritual brothers and sisters and just to love on you this morning and worship you. Father, thank you that you have amazing plans and purposes and a destiny for each one of us. Father, just ask that you would bless Pastor Todd as he teaches today on the bright future that we have in you. We just say to you this morning that we receive the word with joy. And we receive each other in joy this morning as we greet one another. Find a couple people you don't know and say good morning.
in prayer, please. Our Heavenly Father, we do thank you again just for these couple minutes we have here together. We thank you for just this space or this margin in our life, dear God, to just create some space for you to kind of step into our experience. And so we just pray this morning as we're here, as we are experiencing fellowship and worship and connection, that our minds will just kind of be open, that maybe the distractions that are a normal part of our life can just kind of be eliminated for a while so that we can have you speak into our lives in a way that is perhaps unexpected here this morning. We love you, dear God. We thank you so much for loving us enough to send your Son to die in our place. And we pray that this morning, dear God, that you will receive all of the glory and all of the honor forever and ever. Amen. Whoever put these peanut M&Ms on my pulpit, you're my favorite person today, all right? I just want you to know that. I don't know where they came from, but thank you. Hey, we're kind of at the front end of a series of messages that I called Big Promises, and I kind of anchored it in the passage in the book of Genesis. If you remember, Genesis chapter 9 is really God's covenant with Noah after they had just landed, if you would, after 40 days of rain, and then after a period of time for the water to subside, God actually, as they come out of the ark, he actually makes a one-sided promise with them, which is interesting because up in that till that time, almost all of the agreements between God and his people were two-sided. God would say, if you do this, then I will do that. And in the Old Testament, that's known as a covenant, or it's a contract or an agreement between two parties. And all of a sudden in Genesis chapter 9, verses 12, God makes an unconditional covenant with Noah and the world. Or another way of saying that is God actually articulates a promise to his creation. And of course, you know the promise back then was that he would never again do what? He would never again destroy life with floodwaters. And so I kind of anchored off from that, and I tried to share with you that is one of about over 7,800 promises in the Bible that God makes with his creation. And so I shared with you that what we would do is we would start looking at some of these big promises, and I have them kind of linked at this. These are promises where God says, you are, you have, you can, and you will. We started off with, you are. And I shared with you that God promises you that regardless of where you're at in your life, you are never, ever alone. We then moved on and I said, regardless of what you have, your past is like, God promises you that you are forgiven through the saving work of his Son, Jesus Christ. Last week, I said, you have what? Do you remember what last week was about? We talked a little bit about temptation and the struggles we have in our life, and I shared with you that God promises in Scripture that no matter what you're in the middle of, that you have a way out. Today I'm going to look at another promise, and here's the promise for today if you want to jot it down. You have a great future. And it's really God's answer to failure in your life. So here's a quick question, quick survey. How many of you here this morning have somebody sitting next to you? Because I don't want to ask you about yourself, but the person sitting next to you, look at the person to your right and your left. How many of you have a person sitting next to you who has failed? Come on. You got anybody sitting next to you that's failed in life? Now, I know that you haven't failed, but I'm sure the person next to you has failed, right? Well, the interesting thing about failure is that failure brings with it the consequences of your current experience, right? I mean, I was trying to think through different things I've heard from people since I've been in the ministry, of people who have had regrets in life. And here's some of the regrets that I've heard from people in my office. You know, people for years have been telling me that I had a drinking problem, but I just kind of blew them off. Then I hit somebody, and I injured somebody, and I spent some time in jail. And now I have a record because I failed. Or a young woman that I was talking to says, you know, my folks always told me to be careful that conceiving a child at a young age would affect the rest of my life, and I just blew them off as if they didn't know anything, and eventually I got pregnant, and it literally stopped my life. And now I'm a single mom without a high school diploma, basically relying on my parents to get by. And so my current experience is the result of my decisions. Or maybe you're the small child or the teenager that has been told your entire life, be honest. Don't lie. Be a person of integrity, but instead you wanted more, and so you stole or you cheated, and it worked out just fine until you got caught. And now there's a record, and there's consequences connected to it. Or maybe you're a dad, and your wife and your parents have been telling you for years, be careful how you interact with your kids. Be careful how you talk to them, because you just might not have a relationship with them down the road. And now you're middle age and your kids don't call and you have almost no contact. And you look back and say that I was warned, but this is my current experience. I failed. Or maybe you were told, be careful of the people you hang out with. Be careful of your friends. Be careful of your behavior, and you blew it off. And as a result, you're where you are today in life. People will say, you know, I never thought this is where I would be when I'm 20 or 30 or 40 or 50 or 60. I always thought life would look different. And sometimes when you get there, you have this sense that, do I even have a future? And then we dig into our scriptures and we find passages like this. Jeremiah 29, verse 11. It's on posters. It's on t-shirts. In 2019, out of 2.2 billion page views on Bible Gateway, it was the number one viewed passage. And the passage says this, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Now, here's what's interesting about this passage is that this passage gives many, many of us incredible hope, especially when we're feeling stuck in life. But when we read this passage, I'll guarantee you that at least 90% of us are actually misinterpreting what the verse is really saying. Did you know that? This isn't a get-out-of-free jail card where God says, it doesn't matter what you've done, there's not going to be any consequences, but rather I'm going to make sure you have a life that is completely full of hope and it's prospering all the time. That's not what this passage says. See, what this passage is written to is it's written to the Jewish people who are currently in exile. And so the first thing you have to understand when you read this passage is that God's patience has limits. Where God will allow consequences to enter into your life, so hopefully he can use those consequences to turn you in the direction he needs you to go. Any of you have a membership to a fitness center? Only the weird people have memberships, right? When I was in college, I had a membership to a fitness center. It was downtown Grand Rapids, and I didn't have a social life, and so pretty much every night I just went to the fitness center and I worked out. And as a member of the fitness center, you had free access to the different classes they offered at this fitness center. And one of the classes they offered was in the area of learning Taekwondo. Anybody ever learned Taekwondo? And I remember wanting to learn it so desperately, right? And yet all we did for months was stretch. If you're in a martial art, you know what I'm talking about. All you do is stretch, and you leave hurting all the time. But they're trying to build your flexibility so that you can develop a balance. And then they start teaching you moves. And I went for months and months of doing the stretching and learning the basic moves. And then eventually I got to the point where we got to spar with one another. Anybody ever spar with somebody? They put on the head pads on you, and there's a chest pad, and you had gloves on your hands, and there were shin pads on your feet and on your shins, and you got to kick and hit people. And I'll tell you what, if you've never done it, it really, really feels good to hit somebody. Yeah, you laugh, but you haven't been there unless you've done it. And I remember the instructor, as they're teaching you and as you're sparring, you know, there was always a stance you'd have to have, and you'd always be sideways, and you always had one hand protecting your groin, important if you're a guy, all right? And one hand, which is always up, protecting your face. And as you would spar, if you would kick, or as you'd come out and as you would punch, you know, you would do this and you'd get caught up in it, and the instructor would eventually say, "You're dropping your hand again." And I'd put it back up again, and I'd spar, and he says, "You're dropping it, get your hand up," and I'd put it back up, and this went on for a couple weeks, and eventually, one night, I was doing it again, and I kept dropping my hand. He said, "You're dropping your hand, get it up," and I put it down one more time, and he went, boom, right in the middle of the face. And I woke up on the ground. No, I'm serious. I don't know how I got there, but I woke up laying on my back. And I just remember for about 4 or 5 days after that, how bruised my face felt, my nose and my face. I mean, it just kind of lingers for a while. What an insensitive, mean instructor, right? Why did he hit me? Because for weeks, he says, "Get your hand up. Get your hand up. Protect yourself." And it's like this thick head wasn't hearing it. And he realized that he knows of one way that I'll get it no matter what. Now, I wasn't perfect after that, keeping my hand up, but I was sparring and I would always think about it. Every time it would drop, I'd bring it back up again. God is not a taekwondo instructor. But although he is patient and although he is loving, if you continue to be thick-headed and rebellious, he will allow you to experience consequences in hopes of turning you. And so what you have here in Jeremiah 29 is you have the prophet Jeremiah speaking into the experience of everybody that was exiled from Judah. And what you have to understand is that Judah, or the city of Jerusalem, was actually attacked 3 different times by an individual from the Babylonian Empire by the name of King Nebuchadnezzar. Sound familiar in your Bible? King Nebuchadnezzar came in the first time after the Assyrian Empire had kind of conquered the northern kingdom, and he came into the southern kingdom in about 605 to 607 BC. He came in, and he finally, for the first time in Jewish history, he literally conquered the main city of the Jews. And he took over. And it was at that moment that the Jewish king of Jerusalem actually became submissive to a Gentile ruler, King Nebuchadnezzar of the Babylonians. And as a result, he had to serve Nebuchadnezzar, and he did it by paying him royalties, of paying him different payments over the week to kind of show his loyalty to the Babylonian ruler. And the Bible says that this went on for a while until eventually the king of Judah, named by the name of Jehoiakim, got tired of submitting to another authority. Sounds like us, doesn't it? And he saw an opportunity because this alliance was growing between him and the nation of Egypt. And so he began to create this alliance with Egypt, which is interesting because it was just a couple generations before that, the Jews were in captivity to who? To Egypt. So now they're joining with Egypt again, but this time they see them as somebody that can help them overthrow the Babylonians. And so Jehoiakim rebels in about 598-597, with Egypt, and the Babylonians come in and they wipe the Egyptians out, and King Nebuchadnezzar comes into the city of Jerusalem and he does the same to them. And he takes Jehoiakim's son and all of his son's children, along with all of the important educated people of the city, people like, I don't know, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, sound familiar? And he took all of the important people that had the ability to lead the city, and he exiled all of them to Babylon. And so they're all in captivity, and all of the royal people, the educated people, were turned into eunuchs. Daniel was a eunuch. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, eunuch. Guys, that doesn't even sound good. And so he took Jehoiakim out of command, and he replaced him by Zedekiah. And he says, all right, Zedekiah, you're now going to be the king. You now submit to me, and you rule over this area of Babylonian territory. And then what we find is about 3.5 years into Zedekiah's reign, he gets tired of paying royalties to the Babylonians. And the Bible says in 2 Kings chapter 24 and 25 that Zedekiah now, he pairs up with Edom, with Ammon, with Moab, and with the Phoenicians, and he goes to war to try to overthrow the Babylonians. And now, to be honest with you, King Nebuchadnezzar has had enough. And he goes into Jerusalem, and not only does he overthrow the city again, he literally destroys the temple, and he destroys the city walls. It's ashes. And so now you have all these people that have been exiled into Babylonia. They're watching their temple mount, which is really the mount of their god, and the royal city of Jerusalem is completely destroyed, and they're sitting in exile wondering, where did God go? If he really is the God he says he is, how could he let these pagan nations come in and destroy what's so important to us? Well, all he did is he allowed a Gentile ruler, Nebuchadnezzar, to carry out his consequences on a rebellious people. Chances are, where you're in your life is the result of your rebellion. And God has been so patient with you. He's tried to provide you with what you needed. He's tried to direct you. He's tried to put the right people in your life. And yet we get so focused on what we want, and we get so thick-headed we don't listen, that the only way God can get our attention sometime is just to allow us to suffer the consequences of our decisions. Now, if you're there, now hear these words from Jeremiah 29:11. The first thing you learn from this passage is that God is always, always thinking about you all the time. That phrase, therefore, I know the plans I have for you, that word plans is used 3 times in this passage. It's actually a word that can mean to think or to have an intent or to have a plan for something, which means it's always on your mind. I was going through my garage this spring, and I realized up in my rafters of my garage, I didn't realize it, I knew it was there, there is some edging, some leftover edging up in the rafters of my garage. Any of you got any leftover stuff on the top of your garage? Well, there's this landscape fabric that's up there, a partial roll, and there's this landscape edging. Now, I know it's up there because I put it there 5 years ago when I was landscaping the yard. And when I got 2/3 of it done, I have always had the intent on finishing it. And so because my intent is to finish it, I took the remaining materials and I put them up in the rafters of the garage because life was getting busy, things were happening, I had other things to do. Well, that has never gone out of my mind. Every time I walk into my house, I see my unfinished landscape. It haven't forgotten about wanting to finish it. I just haven't gotten to it yet. That's what this word plan means. It means to be constantly in God's thought. Now, I don't know about where you're at today, but that might be the words you need to hear this morning. That regardless of where you're at right now, God is constantly thinking of you. He's aware of where you're at in your life. He's aware of how you're feeling. He's aware of your struggle because he is thinking of you all the time. And that's an odd thing for me because I forget about everything. Anybody set reminders on your phone to remind you of things? I can't remember birthdays. I can't remember anniversaries. Shoot, I can't even remember half of your names half the time. You know, I like to wear name tags, so not so I get to know your name, so I can remember my own name. You know, it's interesting. When we were in the Muskegon area, we planted a church in the Muskegon area from scratch. I think we launched on Easter of 2005. And we launched at a conference center off from, it's called the Trillium Conference Center off from Van Wagner Road, if you're familiar with the area. And so every Sunday, we would have to go into our warehouse where our offices were. We'd have to get the trailer with all the equipment on everything else, and we would haul these trailers over to the conference center. We would spend about an hour and 20 minutes setting everything up. Well, first we'd have to tear down what happened the night before. Then we would set all of our stuff up. We'd have our worship service, and then we'd have to tear everything back down, put it back in the trailers, and bring it back to the warehouse, right? I mean, this was an every Sunday activity. And there was one particular Sunday a couple years into it where my wife says, hey, Annie wants to stay with you today. Make sure you bring her home. And so my wife leaves, and I don't know how old Annie was. Let's see, Annie was probably maybe middle school, maybe just under middle school when we were doing it. And we're getting rid of everything, and it's tearing everything down. And I'm driving, and I pull into the warehouse, and I back the trailer in, and I unconnect, and I get into my truck, and I'm about ready to come home, and all of a sudden it hits me. Where's my kid? I tell you what, I drove as fast as I could back to the conference center, and you know, there's this little kid peering out the front door of the conference center. It's all locked up, and she's peering out the door. Where's my dad? How do you forget something as important as that? We forget everything except one thing. You know what we don't forget? The bad things that happen in our life. We remember those, don't we? But it's interesting, the Bible says in Hebrews 10 that their sins and their lawless acts I will remember no more, God says. But he does remember us. You know, the Bible says that an 18th century German philosopher once said by name of Lessing, says, is this a friendly universe we live in? Is everything against us all the time? Well, God answers your question. He says, no, I'm thinking of you all the time. In fact, not only is he thinking of you, and that's nice to know, but it would also be kind of nice to know what he's thinking about you, wouldn't it? The Bible says that God's thoughts towards us are good. He says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you. That word to prosper means this. It means it's a state of general welfare, which means it's a sense of peace. That word to not harm you means it's a state of ill-being, not to be in a state of misery or distress. And I was looking at some different translations in your body, in your Bible. The English translation says, I have plans for welfare and not for evil. Or Peterson's Message translation says, I have plans to take care of you and not to abandon you. Or the Living translation says, I have plans for good and not for disaster. All the translations are trying to communicate this sense of well-being and preservation that God has in mind for your life.
For an introvert,
and I never say the right thing when I greet somebody. I mean, I'll just be honest about it. And I walked up to their parents, and I went to the one. I says, hey, I've heard so much about you. It's great to finally put a name with a face. And I walked away from these conversations. I'm thinking, you know, I know some stuff that's going on in these families' lives, you know, because we all have our struggles. And I'm thinking, I wonder what they thought about that. I wonder if they were thinking, oh, gosh, what did my kid tell him? Does he really know about this? Is he aware of this dynamic going on in my family? Does he know we're struggling? I mean, do you understand? I mean, immediately I can tell you, hey, I was thinking of you this last week, and you're thinking, oh, was that good or was that bad, right? You don't have to think about that with God. Because the Bible says not only is God thinking of you all the time, but he's thinking well of you. He's telling these people who are suffering the consequences of some really bad decisions, he's telling them, regardless of the decisions you've made and regardless of the fact that you're suffering the consequences of those decisions, it hasn't changed my affection for you. That's pretty cool. Jeremiah 29, verse 10 before this says, you're going to be in captivity for 70 years. How old are you this morning? You know, 70 years, maybe if you're 4 or 5, That's words of hope, right? There's a preferred future for you. If you're 20 or, 29 and counting like some of us, it's not going to happen, is it? This is your experience. This is your consequences. But God remembers you, and he thinks well of you. You know, in Luke chapter 15, there's a parable of what's known as the prodigal son, and you've all heard it a dozen times. What's interesting about the prodigal son story is that when he's off away, he has this moment when he's literally starving, watching pigs. And the Bible says that he has this moment where he comes to his senses, right? He has this epiphany. And it occurs to him that his fathers, the people who serve his father, have plenty to eat. Even the people who serve his father that aren't even family, hired hands, always have enough to eat. They have a place to sleep. They have enough to eat. They're well taken care of. And so he decides, well, that's better than what I have here. And it's interesting because as you go through that story, he says that I will go back and this is what I'll do. He says, I will tell my father that I'm no longer worthy to be called his son. I'll just ask him to hire me. What's he saying? I know my father is sitting there stewing about how bad I've wronged him. And all he's doing is having evil intentions about me. And I'm going to go home, he's going to be all riled up, and all he's going to want to do is punish me, and so I got to come in humbly, and I got to come in under the radar and say, I understand what I did was wrong, there's nothing I can do, will you just hire me? And what does the Bible tell you about the prodigal son? He comes home, and then in verse 20 it says this, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him and ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. A little bit different response than the older brother, right? The older brother did it right, right? Can't believe you killed the fattened calf for this son of yours. I'm not even going to admit he's my brother, who has wasted all of his money on prostitutes in another land. He had it right, right? Evil intentions all the way across the board. The father, representing God the Father, allows us to experience consequences, but it doesn't change his affections for us. And then the last one is this. God also intends to give us what I would call a future of hope. There's that phrase there where it says, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Now, if you were to go into the Hebrew language, most scholars, and I don't want to argue with them because I know my Hebrew, but I don't know it that well, would tell you that the word hope and the word future should actually be put together. And so a better way of translating it is, he says, not to harm you, but plans to give you a hopeful future. In those two words there, future means it's a time yet to come, and hopeful means that there's a feeling that some desire will be fulfilled. And so when you read this, and when Jeremiah is telling these people who are exiled in Babylonia, he says that God's plans are to give you a hopeful future. What he's telling them, he says, is that eventually there will be a culmination of your divine appointment. Right? Ephesians 2:10 says, for each of us are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works prepared in advance for us to do. There's this sense that there is a plan for your life. And God promises you, and if you don't get anything else, hear this today. He promises you that regardless of the consequences you may be experiencing right now, he will work out, granted you put him in control of your life, his divine appointment and purpose for your life. You may have a little setback now, but he will work his plan out in your life, in his time, and in his way. In fact, there's a story in the book of Genesis, and you can see this play out, Genesis chapter 42 through Genesis 50. There's this youngest son at the time. His name was Joseph. You ever hear the guy in your Bible? At the time, there were only 11 kids. Eventually, Joseph's father had another little boy, And his name was Benjamin, and he was the youngest, but Joseph was the youngest at the time. And the Bible says that Joseph was his father's favorite, which makes sense because all the other brothers were born to the ugly wife. The Bible says Leah, she had weak eyes. Not quite sure what that looks like. Maybe she was cross-eyed. I don't know what it means. But his heart was for Leah's sister, right? And Joseph was the only one born to her. And so his father couldn't help but treating him differently. And not only did he treat him differently by giving him a robe, but the Bible says that God's hand was on Joseph's life and he was giving Joseph dreams. And he was communicating to Joseph that someday Joseph was going to be used in a special way for God. Now, before you raise Joseph up on a pedestal, read the account a little bit more on how he would go out into the fields and the Bible says, and he would come back with a bad report on his brothers. You can sense the sibling rivalry, can't you? Or when he'd have his dream and he'd have this special revelation, who do you think were the first people he went to share it with? He'd go out and he'd share it with his brothers. And the Bible says, and so they hated him more. It's almost like he was rubbing their nose in it. And we know he was a little bit out of line because the Bible says he actually shared his last dream with his father, and his father became so upset he rebuked him. He's saying, "You stupid kid, what are you doing?" What happened to Joseph? Yeah, he ended up sold by his brothers. You know why he was sold by his brothers? It was the consequences of the anger they had on him, which were the consequences of Joseph rubbing their nose in it all the time. Joseph experienced the results of his failed decisions. But look how God walked through him from the time he was in Potiphar's household to the time he was imprisoned. Over and over again, the Bible says, and God was with Joseph. And even during all those moments, God worked with him until eventually the door opened and God provided the opportunity for his will to be worked out. I got a sneaky suspicion, dear God, it doesn't take us a lot of energy and effort to think back over our lives of things we've said and things we've done and things we've neglected and things we've been warned about and things we've just kind of ignored. And eventually, dear God, they led to consequences in our life. And when we don't have a grasp of this sense, dear God, that you're thinking of us and that you're with us and that you will work out your will in our life, if we return back to you, we have a tendency to not have patience for you to work in our lives. And we try to work things out ourselves. And we get angry with you, thinking, what kind of a God can you be to let this stuff happen in our life? But as Jeremiah said to the exiles, it's better to be in Babylon and to turn and have a relationship with you than it is to be in the promised city of Jerusalem and to be rebelling and to be isolated from your graces. And so we just pray for a turn, for a relationship with you. We thank you, dear God, for your love, for your grace, for the gift of your Son, dear God, that allows us to repent and to turn to you this week. And we lift this all up in his name here this morning. Amen.
Well, good morning, church. Good morning. Ended up being a beautiful day to come worship with you. Appreciate the rain showers overnight because now we know all the flowers are just going to explode. I don't know if you're watching the little crab apple tree out here, but the trees at our house, too, are snowy white against the blue sky. It's been gorgeous all week. So just thankful for a little turn in the weather here these last few weeks. I am Michelle DeKuyper. I'm the elder on call this week. If you have a prayer request for yourself, for friends or family, you're more than welcome to zip me an email or you can call it into the church office and they'll let us know. It can be kept between you and I or it can be shared with a team of elders and you'll have a whole team praying over your request. If you have praise you'd like to share, we'll also join you in giving thanks to God for the good blessings he's given you in your life. In a moment here, our deacons are going to come take our tithes and offerings. There are other ways also to give by the plate, or if you want to do a more digital type thing, you're more than welcome to do that. It's not that you have to give. We want to have cheerful givers. Just pray where God is leading you in that. And we'll say a prayer for the offering, and then they'll come forward. Our Father, again, thank you for today. Thank you for a beautiful day to serve and worship you, Lord, to come into your house among other believers and just have, to me, this hour just feels like this quiet time. There's not so many demands. We're not running to and from this or that. We're just focused on you, Lord. And I would pray that throughout this week, just walk with each one of us. Remind each one of us that you're as near as a whisper, Lord, and you keep your promises. Direct each one of us to find the promise that we need to keep us going through this week, Lord. And I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning again. Just a couple of reminders of what we have going on in the next month here. We got some great opportunities to hang out together. A quick reminder that we're starting a new life group tomorrow morning next door at the ministry house. It's called Israel Unveiled. Looks like it's going to be pretty cool. Check the website for the ongoing life groups. You're welcome to hop into any of them anytime. Now, who's got some extra junk hanging out around their property? Anybody? Anybody junk in your garage, junk in your house? Anybody doing spring cleaning yet? We will help you out with that. We've got the spring garage sale coming up 2 weeks from yesterday. So this week and next week, you have the opportunity to bring all of that. Did I say junk? I meant all that really, really good stuff here to the yard sale. The pole barn will be open each day from 9 to 1. If that doesn't work for you, just let us know and we'll make other arrangements for it to be open for you. We want to help you get everything cleaned up for the spring. And all the proceeds from the yard sale will go towards the kitchen remodel project. So we're moving ahead on that one. Coming up towards the end of the month, we're going to have a baptism at the outdoor service. And then also on June 1st, we're going to be doing a membership class. So two things coming up towards the end of the month there. We do have to have you sign up for them. Sign-up deadline is Friday. So if you want to be involved in the baptism or the membership class, sign up in the church office, the email, cheers card, whatever method works best for you. Sign up by Friday, please. And as I mentioned, first outdoor service coming up at the end of the month. Whew, it's not quite the same sign of summer that like Dairy Queen opening is, but you know, it's a pretty good sign of summer, right? All right, stand up. Let's sing our way out of here.
What a great time with the Lord this morning, huh? Let's just go singing praise to Jesus.
Who tells the sun to rise every morning? Colors the sky with the shades of his glory. Makes us with mercy and love. Jesus does. Who holds the orphan? The widow cries for injustice, feels every sorrow, carries the pain of his children. Jesus does. So we sing praise to the Father who gave us the Son, and praise to the Spirit who's living in us. When I was a sinner, his grace over all our mistakes, washes us clean with his blood, and Jesus does. Who sings a song of sweet forgiveness? Who stole the keys of hell and the grave? Thank you.
Come on, sing.
So we sing praise to the Father who gave us the Son. Praise to the Spirit who's living in us. When I was a sinner, He saved me.
Parting blessing. Go in peace. It's an experience of well-being. May that peace be yours, a peace that surpasses all human understandings, because there is a God that loves you so much that He gave His one and only Son to die for you. May His Spirit convict you of that and guide you every day of your life. Amen. Go in peace. Have a great weekend.
Thank you for joining the MCRC live stream today. Everything you need to be a part of our online extended family can be found just below this video. You can subscribe to this channel for instant access to future videos and live streams, share this link with a friend, access our website, subscribe to weekly email updates, or give online to help us continue to reach people for Christ. Thanks again for joining us. Have a great weekend.